I'm Madalina Mihanake. I'm head of the European Parliament Information Office. It is a pleasure to welcome you here at the representative office of the European Parliament to Romania. Thank you for taking the time to participate in the debates on the draft regulation of the European Parliament and the Council regarding the Single European Sky 2+. The key aspects as well as the consequences of SES will be debated by the most important institutions and organizations in the field of aviation in Romania. In a dialogue with the member of the European Parliament, Marian-Jean Marinescu, who is a rapporteur on this draft regulation. He is member of the Commission for Transport and Tourism from the European Parliament and Vice President of EPP. At today's debates, as I said, will participate key actors in the field of aviation in Romania and internationally. We would like to thank the panelists for participating. Mr. Virgil Dragoș, State Secretary in the Ministry of Transport, Mr. Andrei Filipoiu, Director in the National Romania Aviation Authority, Ionorel Stanciu, working for ROMATSA, Air Traffic Control, Mr. Philippe Moron, International Affairs Director from IATA, Assistant Director, and Andrei Cârsta, Operational Control Center Manager, the National Airlines Company, TAROC. The moderator will be Mr. Dan Carbonaro. He is a journalist specialized in European affairs. The draft regulations aims at better managing the European sky and upgrading the current system in order to build a long-term sustainable safety aviation system. Now we have 800 million passengers in more than 440 airports in Europe. Every day that means 27,000 flights that cross the sky of Europe. That means about 9 million flights per year. 80% of them are operated inside the EU airspace. We believe that in the future, on the current growth perspective, we will see an increase by 3% of air traffic per year. The forecast is for 50-year more air traffic in the next 20 years. That means that Europe will be faced with an unparalleled number of flights. Also, perhaps a number of unparalleled situations of cancelled flights or delayed flights. That means that if we preserve the current trends, we will see an increase of cost by 50% by 2050. In Europe, because of the fragmentation of the airspace, there are 42 kilometers more covered by each plane than necessary. That means longer flight time, higher fuel consumption, as well as high CO2 emissions. We estimate that the changes brought by the regulation will decrease cost, will save time, as well as fuel. The first package of measures under SES was adopted in 2004. It was then upgraded in 2009 under SES2, and the current proposal, SES2+, will accelerate the reform of air navigation services. Before giving the floor to the rapporteur and the experts in order to dwell on this topic, perhaps it is important to point out the concern of the European Parliament, who will keep listening carefully, as it has done so far, to the concerns of the stakeholders, that who will take the consequences of the new legislation to be passed by the European Parliament, in order to promote collective European interest hand in hand with domestic and sectoral interest. Last but not least, the purpose of European legislation is to make a contribution so as to create the right framework to build a strong, competitive and performing Europe, one, a Europe of solidarity that can cope with current challenges and the challenges from 20 years ahead or decades ahead. Through the role of the European Parliament is to represent the European citizens in a sustainable development project facing the current and future challenges, and to protect the right of European citizens to a prosperous, safe ride in the context of the state of law. These debates, where we always invite the representatives of the press, represent the expression of the European Parliament to listen and to incorporate the points of view of the European citizens represented by the MEPs. And now allow me to give the floor to the moderator, Mr. Dan Carbonaro. Good morning. Thank you, Mrs. Mihalake, for giving me the floor. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a pleasure to come here again at the office of the European Parliament to Romania. I hope that today's debates will add value from the perspective that was introduced earlier by Mrs. Mihalake. We need to know better the current situation, including the situation in this important sector. Figures are telltale, but the prosperity and the safety of European citizens are still the desiderata of all member states, including Romania, one of the countries that where there is a high potential for growth. On the agenda, there are interesting and relevant topics, both for the participants present here and those that watch us online. We would like to thank the members of the press for taking the invitation launched by the Office of the European Parliament. However, there is streaming through Euractiv Romania, and together with our colleagues, we decided to take over the broadcast and disseminate the information in such a way. Having said that, it is my pleasure to give the floor to Marian-Jean Marinescu. He is a member in the Committee for Transport and Tourism from the European Parliament, Vice President of the EPP. He will tell us about the role and the importance of SES in consolidating the internal European market. Therefore, Mr. Marinescu, you have the floor. Thank you. Good morning from me. As Mrs. Madalina Mihalake said before, this is a new program of the European Parliament, the General Directorate for Communication, trying to put across the information to all the citizens and put across the effort of the EP in this legislative process. We decided on a number of files that will be debated throughout Europe, and I was glad to see that also this topic was selected by the Office of the EP. Starting last week, we started a row of conferences. This is the second in the round of conferences. Good morning. The first was in the Netherlands, in Maastricht, in an air traffic center, quite well known and highly specialized. as a matter of fact, that supports in principle this report. We are here now, and the same kind of conference will be organized in Warsaw, in Berlin, Vienna, and Madrid, and hopefully Paris. Though there we have the only office of the EP that hasn't taken our invitation yet, and perhaps later on I'll tell you why. The single European sky, what is it? I suppose you know what we want to implement. I was the rapporteur for this topic back then, also for the EASA. Now I'm a rapporteur for the EPP group for the same topic. These topics always go hand in hand. 5 years ago, I tried to introduce a definition, and it was quite difficult to do so in the negotiations with the Council. Finally, it was included in a recital. For the very reason that there it was mentioned that air traffic control should rely on technical issues and not national frontiers. I managed to introduce that in the recital of the report. Now it is no longer part of the draft regulation, but there is Article 1, Paragraph 1, saying in fact what we want with this new draft regulation. There is another problem, because the Commission speaks only about technical criteria, and that only word has been excluded. The reason is the fact that now air traffic control is based on the territorial principle of national borders. What about the status at play of the report? It has been voted, the text of the report was voted, was passed in the EP, and in December last year we have the final result of the negotiations in the Council. You know that in Europe the Commission has the initiative, the Parliament will debate upon the draft legislation. The Council and the Parliament will negotiate, and if they come to agree, it will be passed in first reading, then the two texts will be voted, and there will be a second reading and negotiation. Now we are in between the stages, because in the Council we've seen some unreasonable, unjustified delays. The Latvian presidency and the Greek presidency have not launched any debates on the report. It was under pressure of other member states that we did, and only the Italian presidency in the second semester of last year showed a wish, the willingness to move forward with these two topics in the Council. And now we have a text, and we have another problem with Gibraltar, but we hope to be able to overcome that problem too and be able to start negotiations. Why we haven't done so far? Because there were some wishes for this regulation to be delayed by the member states. I will tell you about the position of the Parliament and the Commission, and notably the Parliament, as well as the position of the member states. There are some differences between the two texts proposed, and that is why there have been some attempts to block this report on the way. As I was saying, what is SES, the Single European Sky? This is a concept that wants the definition and the regulation of air traffic. I'm sorry, but the microphone stopped working. Right now, we have in Eurocontrol 35 air traffic units in Europe, 28 members, and service providers, they are called. and 65 air traffic traffic control centers. So this architecture of the sky is based on national frontiers. Well, we have no more national frontiers on land. And it happened in a very short time compared to SES. The Schengen space emerged in 1885 as an idea, and in 95 we see the disappearance of the first frontiers. The first time we talked about SES was in 1999, and now we are in 2015. The first initiative was in 2004. We made no progress until 2000. We had SES-2. We negotiated with a lot of difficulties several aspects. The most important was some definition about FAB, which I don't agree with. To my mind, this is a useless stage. It was a pretext for member states to delay this achievement of SES. But bearing in mind that we couldn't leave aside the opinion of the Council, however, we could negotiate on the deadline of 3 years. I negotiated for the report for 6 months. The translation took 9 months to be published in the official journal. So we covered quite a long way from the 3 years. The 3 years meant December 2012, and nothing happened when it comes to FABs. So in this direction, we made only small steps in this sector. SES,
as Madalina said, would bring various benefits. Gain of time for a 2-hour flight, we would gain 7 to 14 minutes, less fuel, which means less CO2. A shorter flight and a better organization of the air traffic control. So all these are benefits mainly for the passengers. I wouldn't say it's a conflict, but I know that there is quite a heated debate between the airlines and the air traffic service providers. In the air, we have millions of passengers every year. They are the true beneficiaries of the system. So that's what we should be thinking about in the first place. Of course, we want the airlines to go on operating, but they are not the beneficiaries. The beneficiaries of this transportation are the passengers. So all the benefits that we believe will be brought forward by the single European sky will be for the passengers. And one of these benefits will be a lower ticket price. Of course, we can compare our system with that of the United States. This is always a perspective to consider. As you know, the US have 10.4 a million square meters of air space, and they only have one provider, a single air service provider, and they have 20 air traffic centers. Europe has 11.5 million square meters air traffic space, but we have 65 air traffic control centers and 38 service providers. In Europe, we have more air traffic controllers than the US, whereas the US has many more flights than Europe. So it means that they perform a lot better than us. And the costs in the US are lower per flight hour than in Europe. So as you can see, it can be. Now, with your permission, I will try to touch upon the differences between the two texts. As I said, the Council adopted the text in December. Unfortunately, Great Britain came up with an objection about the airport in Gibraltar. As you know, they have a territorial dispute there. Spain and the UK and even Germany. Unfortunately, we have elections this year. Let's be frank about it. Every member state will try to win a few votes from this dispute. And this might block the entire report, the entire regulation. This means that there will be an impact on the reports on airports. There will be an impact on the rights of passengers. This is another important report. There are also reports prepared concerning air pollution, noise, etc. So now let's go over the differences between the Parliament's text and the Council's text. There are many of them, but I will only touch upon the serious ones. I think that the text produced by the Council is weaker than the one adopted in 2008. This means that they want to delay the adoption of the SES as long as they can. For the FABs, we don't have a deadline at all. We don't know when they will come to happen. Because if they did, it would mean that out of the 28 entities separated by borders, we would have 9 entities. Which is completely useless. In the 5 years that have passed, nothing was done. For each FAB, what they managed to do was to write and print about a room full or two of papers, of paperwork. So nothing concrete, no progress. Well, actually, something was done. Well, I'll give you the chance to tell me later. Let's look at the first article. There are two authorities right now, two national authorities. We have the National Air Authority, Aviation Authority. This is the authority that audits service providers. Yes, the National Supervisory Authority. This is the control or the auditing authority, which oversees service providers. And this authority is mentioned by the regulation. The Parliament would like to have a single authority instead of two. I don't see why we should have two instead of one. Why? Because for the European Union, we only have one authority. And logically, I think we only need one authority at European level with subsidiaries in the member states. Why? Because the two of them, the two national authorities, have the same tasks that are handled by the single European authority. The report on the European authority and the SES actually ask for the same thing. But this is actually something which has been derived from the reality out there on the field. These authorities usually operate within the same premises. They have the same employees. People switch from one to the other. So I don't think it would be a problem. On the other hand, we stress the fact that the authority should be completely independent. Why? Because the authority will check, will audit services, personnel, airports, everything that has to be monitored in this industry for the main reason that of ensuring flight security. Now, the Council does not agree with our view. Actually, the Council does not fully agree with our concept of independence. The Council agrees that the authority could be independent, but it should operate within the same framework of services in that European state. The Council has a very interesting choice of words here. They try to keep all these authorities, all these services under the same umbrella. And I'm going to show you proof for this. Now, the performance scheme is another point which is different in our view from that of the Council. The Council suggests that when the national performance plan is adopted both by the national authority and by the national operator, TAROM in our case, right, the national airline, and by the other space users, then the Commission has to take into account that plan. When the Commission checks the plan and if the Commission finds that the plan is not in line with the European targets, the Commission may change it. So the Council says, if the authority that wrote up the plan, if the service provider, if the airport and if the airline agree to adopt the plan, then the plan has to be implemented. But all these bodies are not independent from each other, because when you want to talk to them, you have to call the ministry. They are all subordinated to the minister. So this is the main difference. The Council also says that the national authority can be under the same framework of services, which means that the authority is not necessarily independent. It can be independent, but it can be part of the same service. This is the case of France, which has a single service, one director, and 20,000 people subordinate. And France is the one blocking the regulation. And I have several other examples. The Parliament wants to have a performance review body for the performance scheme. This is a body that should check the national performance plans. The Parliament would like this body to be independent, would like this body to be a European economic regulator. We know that all the member states regulate their own public services. So why should we not have a regulator at the European level for this sector? Why not have an independent European regulator that could have the authority to state very clearly whether the performance plans are well thought or not? If these problems, if these plans are not correct, then the Parliament says that the Commission should be able to block the plan by starting an examination procedure. This should be a procedure which is in place for all the documents that need to be approved by the Commission. So this would This would be a part of the payment scheme, so when the cost of the service is decided. The Commission should be able to have a financial mechanism that would allow the investments to be synchronized with the new technologies proposed by CSR. So we should have a synchronization in the air and on the ground. We have a great example,
data link,
which is great for airplanes, and it was introduced more by airplanes than by service providers. I know that the airlines had to make a financial effort. Unfortunately, this effort is useless so far because they cannot yet use this system. There are other discrepancies between the two texts. Maybe we will come back to them later. Now, the arguments against, arguments that I had to face ever since 2008 when I became the rapporteur. Sovereignty is the first. People who object to this regulation say that if we don't have any borders, then we lose our sovereignty. But actually, we do not have borders on the ground. And anyway, right now, there are places where, for natural reasons, for technical reasons, one state has to control the airspace of another state. Think of Bratislava. You won't be able to convince me that they connect with Bratislava only because they have to know. Otherwise, the planes would be falling down. For Maastricht, they control the airspace of four states: Belgium, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, and Germany. So we have such cases already. Then, the second argument, safety. There is no danger. Actually, the European single sky improves the safety. It will not diminish it by any means. Actually, the single European sky will have joint air traffic control systems, and this will only contribute to increasing flight safety. I visited a center in Maastricht and another in France. There are big differences between the two. Now, the military argument. This has lost a lot of weight because actually, the military services were much more willing than the civil services to adopt the system. I'm talking about the north of France, south of Germany, and Belgium, where I know that there are lots of problems from this point of view. And I gave you the example of Maastricht. There, they were able to solve this problem really nicely. God forbid there should be an accident in the airspace of another state.
Route map.
Think of Zurich, Amsterdam. You know that they don't fly, they don't take a straight line when flying, they have to zigzag. So this kind of flying still happens in Europe. Now, of course, things have improved significantly. We have some more direct routes, but they could be even more direct. Now, what is the problem? If we have direct routes, it means that some member states would lose a lot of money because planes will no longer transit their airspace, and we're talking hundreds of millions here. So obviously, I can't understand why passengers should pay for this money. I think we can find other methods to help member states overcome this period. One member state that would lose a lot of flights would be Belgium, for instance, because many would have to move to France. A new configuration, a new organization of the airspace would bring about staff changes. The trade unions said that many jobs would be lost. We've had this discussion lots of times, but nobody has an exact figure. We don't have a concrete proposal yet for a new organization of the airspace. We don't know how many centers would be left and what would be the implications for the staff. Maybe some of the staff would be moved to another center, not necessarily fired. Now, Cesar, you know that there is a new research system, a new research program of the European Union, and there are billions of euro invested for air traffic control. The US has a similar project called Next Gen, which is more advanced than ours. So it's obvious that we have to keep going and to finish what we started. We have a deployment manager, the bidding has finished, there is a director. What will we do with these new technologies? Are we going to implement them on the current air traffic organization? Will we burden the national budgets? Because that's where the money will come from. And these monies will be wasted. I think that the new technologies should be applied to a new configuration, to other centers. Maybe they will have to move, to shift. But we are talking huge monies here. Even the companies that deliver these companies cannot work with 28 different sets of equipment. They have to standardize and to work with less money.
Normally, some view this as a conflict between traffic control and those who are in support of SES, which is not right. The cost of tickets of airfares includes only 7% for traffic control, air traffic control. And if we reach the initial target from 1999 to reduce cost by 50%, well, 3% does not represent a lot. Reducing cost can be achieved through direct routes and a new configuration of the space, of the sky. And then we will have some results that can serve the industry and the passengers as well. Allow me to conclude by saying that air transport contributes to economic growth of the EU. So we must develop it in such a way so as to bring economic benefits to the Union, such as connectivity. And connectivity means a better economy. It is not about air traffic control from land. Some on land, but 600 million people in air every year. So we should think of this upper space. We should think of those passengers and their need to go from one place to another for the sake of tourism or for business. Perhaps my speech was too long, but I hope that will cause a lot of debates later on. Thank you, MEP. Indeed, it was a challenging and inciting presentation. I hope that you will ask questions during the Q&A session, because I know that many of those who took our invitation represent the stakeholders from the industry as well as from the civil society. So I hope it will be an interesting debate during the Q&A. Before that, we will keep in mind your idea. Do we speak about the industry or the passengers? We should speak about both. 600 million passengers, you said. Much more than the number of population. The EU population is less than that. So that represents an important figure. We should also think about the 200,000 people working in this sector as such. And we should couple the member state interest with the citizens' interest. But this debate strengthens the approach of the most democratic institution of the EU, that is the EP, trying to find the best solution serving the citizens. And today we're speaking about SES. Thank you for your presentation. And now allow me to give the floor to State Secretary Virgil Dragoș from the Ministry of Transport. Minister, you have the floor.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for the invitation. From the moment Romania joined the EU in 2007, the acquis communautaire became mandatory and directly applicable in Romania. In the context of compliance with SES, starting 2006, Romania created a specific body that will supervise air safety in civil aviation. The Ministry of Transport and the specific division has the competence to provide services, and they are independent from ANSPs. Moreover, starting the 1st of January last year, once the services were transferred to ROMATSA, the certified operator for air navigation services and the delegation to the Ministry of Transport of some of the competences in the field of air safety, ROMATSA has taken over all the charges of the NSA according to SES. That means a separation between the two bodies, NSA and ANS. Given the constraints of the geographical frontier and given the context of joining the EU from Romania and Bulgaria, in Romania, Bulatsa and ROMATSA have signed an initiative to create an FAB, including Romania and Bulgaria. From the very beginning, this was supported by the Ministries of Transport, and it was implemented in 2011 in December by signing in Brussels an agreement to implement an FAB on the 16th of November 2012, according to SES2. The purpose of this FAB is allowing the two states to use in common the airspace to improve the cost, to improve air safety and air control, as well as to mitigate the effect on the environment. We should also say that after the assessment of the FAB, the European Commission notified Romania in 2012 on the fact that the plan and the performance objectives adopted by Romania in 2012-2014 are compatible with the European objectives and they contribute to meeting the European objectives. However, according to the assessment of the Commission, it resulted that the implementation program, so as to create the targeted benefits, will exceed the deadline. That is why a procedure was launched against Romania and Bulgaria. For us, as many other member states in Romania and many other member states of the EU. However, Romania and Bulgaria continued, and on the 11th of December last year, we started with the first cross-border procedures. As for SES2+, as we informed during the meeting of the Ministries of Transport in the EU, from Vilnius on the 16th of September 2013, Romania supports the initiative to create an SES and to overcome the obstacles in front of the two legislative packages previously developed, and considers that the improvement should lead to the simplification and facilitation of the implementation framework. In this context, Romania supports the idea of convergence between legislation under SES and ES and the functioning of EASA, trying to avoid any certainties on the conditions. In the view of the Ministry of Transport in Romania, a clear separation between EASA and the European Commission will eliminate any misunderstanding in the regulation. It is important to have one single set of consistent norms, one legislation, and the necessary expertise. We need bodies that would be responsible with efficient planning and capitalizing on the experience of the industry. SES 2 Plus, inside the working group, enjoyed the support of Romania for two amendments. Regarding the supervising authorities, NSA, we support the idea of independence as well as the expertise of the personnel needed to implement their activity. We want to eliminate the hierarchical dependence to any supervisory body that might not be interested in national services. Secondly, regarding the support services, Romania believed that this can create new opportunities for ATMs, but could also allow for a faster implementation and a cheaper implementation of the new technologies in the framework of maintaining and enhancing safety. However, support services such as communication and navigation, weather assistance, are critical with respect to flight safety, similar to air traffic, and should be considered as such. Romania agreed on the implementation of competitive ANSP at a pan-European level, also approved the consortium of ANSPs only after a feasibility study that is written in consultation with the other member states. Allow me to assure you of our full support, our openness and cooperation of the Ministry of Transport, Minister Rus, and his team of experts. Thank you. Thank you, State Secretary. Practically, you opened a new topic in the debates of today, the impact of the benefits of SES. I believe that you strengthened the conviction of the member of the European Parliament, namely that Romania supports such an initiative. And now allow me to give the floor to Andrei Filipoiu, director in the safety direction from the Romanian Aeronautical Authority. On the implications of SES 2 regulation on the supervising activities. Good morning. Good morning, Member of the European Parliament, Secretary of State. Thank you for the invitation. It's an honor to have been invited. I will try to be as brief as possible, given that part of the elements in my presentation have already been developed or tackled upon by the previous speakers. The main element in my presentation will regard the developments from the field of SES and why it was necessary to have a single European sky. the need of promoting the draft SES 2+. And last but not least, the consequences of SES 2+ on NSA's activity in Romania. As I said earlier, a single European sky was an initiative of the European Commission. In 2000, a high-level working group was put in place in order to analyze whether it is possible to have a single European sky. The working group identified several problems member states were faced with: the organization and implementation of European air traffic services, and also the high fragmentation of the European airspace, as well as lack of technology regarding interoperability. The working group wrote a proposal to the Commission, and the main point there, I know that the member of the European Parliament did not like the idea of FABs, but that was precisely the idea, to have FABs in Europe. This is how a legal framework was, a technical and operational framework was developed that regulated the need for these FABs. Later on, SES 1 was developed and then it was turned into SES 2, establishing as the deadline for implementation end of December 2012, the moment then the FABs would be functional as well. SES relies on three fundamental pillars: performance, safety, technology, airport capacity, and the human factor. All these five pillars are regulated through Regulation 216 of EASA and four other regulations of the Commission: a framework regulation 549 on services, the airspace regulation, and 552 as well. I would like to underline Regulation 552, and we will see later on why this regulation is important for us as an authority. Moving on, we can see that we still need to increase efficiency of NSA's activity through the performance plan, and I have in mind capacity, cost, and efficiency, and that we keep on preserving a system, a fragmented air traffic management. That is why SES 2+ emerged, a proposal made to the Parliament and the Council by the Commission. Both of them, the Parliament and the Council, made their own comments on this proposal, and this is how we had the SES 2+ package. Of course, SES 2+ regards the ineffectiveness of the aviation services in Europe and the fragmentation of the ATM system. In 2014-2015, the management system of air traffic is somehow very specific for each country. Every ANSP has its own implemented system, provides navigation services on narrow spaces. We can't still speak about something very similar to what happens in the USA. There is a single provider, a single ANSP. Given all these elements, SES2 Plus comes with some novelty elements, increasing the independence of NSA, improving the performance scheme, increasing efficiency of the support services, increasing the role of EASA, and changing the terminology. As for the independence of NSA, or better independence of NSA, that is created through functional independence. As the State Secretary said, we had that functional independence starting 2006. And at the beginning of 2014, the Romanian Aeronautical Authority separated part of their activities and made it into an independent body. As for the performance scheme can be improved, but we must consider that we as an authority supervise operators, airports, and also air navigation services. The unit rate in Europe is in Romania half of the unit rate in Austria, let's say. The unit rate in Austria is almost 74 euros. In Romania, it's about 34 euros. So we should calibrate this in Europe, and we should see how we can really improve the performance scheme, because the level we have reached is good enough in terms of efficiency. But there should be the same measure applied to all. Increasing the efficiency of the support services.
If we have a free market for weather services, if we have more competition, then we will see results. Competition is generally good, but we have to remember that anything which is new in space well known by the natives might affect the performance. So I think we should envisage a cooperation between the weather services and an authority such as ROMATSA. We have a pretty tight cooperation, but if we have a new weather service, let's say, in the beginning, I think we might see some risks. This is why I think we really need a very good and detailed risk analysis before we go this way. Now, increasing the competences of the EASA. Yes, indeed, the agencies has more tasks in matters of safety, in matters of economics, why not, and interoperability as well. We have to be very careful here. When I speak about interoperability, I'm thinking of draft regulation 216 and the SES2 Plus regulation. SES2 Plus, together with the new 216 regulation, comprise elements that were taken from the five regulations I mentioned earlier. But even regulation 552, which covers interoperability, was not included fully in SES2 Plus or in the new draft 216, which is why we here in Romania, but I think all other authorities would agree, which is why it's difficult for us to operate in an area where there is such a huge legal vacuum, because we are directly affected by the lack of provisions. Now, this is an introduction that I wanted to give you to show you how the authority would be impacted. Now, another impact would be that we have to ensure independence, capability, and a better recruitment process. These are key elements for us as a national supervisory authority. Now, the Parliament, as our MEP said, wants the NSA to become the NAA, the national authority, and the EASA should become the EAA. What does this mean? Our aeronautical authority should be accredited by the EAA at the European level. Well, there are several things to consider here, and I think the impact is less relevant for our authority. The impact is bigger for the member state, for the government. I told you about interoperability earlier, and I said that the provisions from 552 were not completely included in the new regulation. But we support ES2+, and we were always consulted with regards to the elements and to the provisions adopted by the Council of the Parliament. We were part of the Council Aviation Working Group. Now, we're not criticizing this draft regulation. It's not in our best interest. We note that there is an improvement. The purpose is to increase the financial viability. We want cheaper ticket prices. We are all aware of these benefits. So we don't reject the regulation. We just want to make a few observations. And I think together with you, we should try to find solutions in order to solve all the deficiencies. Mr. Frank Brenner said once that he's a general director of the Eurocontrol. He said that either we all sing together, either we all soar together. Well, this is what we want to do, and our authority will support you in implementing this program. You can count on us. Thank you. Thank you. No, of course, we don't think criticism is bad. I think criticism can be helpful in order to achieve a better regulation. Yes, indeed, we can sink or swim together, and we can travel in various ways. I see we are on schedule with our agenda, but I'm still going to ask the following speakers to try to limit their time. I'm going to ask now the General Director of the Safety Directorate of Romatsa, Mr. Ionovel Stanciu, to take the floor. He will talk about stimulation, performance, competition. I see that my microphone keeps turning off. It's not my fault, says the speaker. So, Mr. Ionovel Stanciu, you have the floor. Thank you. I'd like to thank the organizers, first of all, and to congratulate them for this idea. The subject is very topical, and I'm sure it will lead to serious debates here. Mr. Marinescu, our MEP, whom I met several years ago, gave me a few topics that I would like to touch upon. Yes, you're right. Out of the 9 fabs, 8 are actually useless, but one of them actually worked. And we actually pride ourselves on the two cross-border sectors and a route. 10 days ago, I was in Bulgaria, and I noticed that our cooperation is very good. And actually, the challenge comes from another side. Our Bulgarian colleagues informed us that Turkey is getting very serious on the border. On the Bulgarian side, they only accept 2 entry-exit points. They want 20 miles space between the airplanes, the aircraft, whereas we allow them to have 10 miles. But this can create problems. As I told the State Secretary, I believe we need to have a dialogue, including with the network manager from Eurocontrol, and we should try to find a solution. Because, as you said, the passenger is the center point of our attention. You talked about SES and SES 2 Plus. Well, I want to point out that the European Commission found that the services provided by the NSAs are inefficient and that the air traffic control system is too fragmented. As the previous speaker said, this was actually the main topic, the main area of interest for the SES 2 Plus package. We know that the European Commission made an impact assessment with regards to flight efficiency, cost efficiency, administration cost, capacity, and the rest. But I think we should consider the social impact as well, because if we lose 200,000 jobs from the authorities, this will be huge. I'm not going to dwell on the objectives because you're familiar with them. You know the entire ABC. In order to attain the objectives of the single European sky, ROMATSA has to invest in its structure of air traffic management a lot of money. We have a program which is called ATM 2015 Plus. It's an ongoing program, and at the end of it, at the end of 2016, when we hope it will be fully implemented, we will have one of the best performing and the most modern air traffic management systems in Europe. Of course, we need to invest a lot of money in order to ensure interoperability and to implement the FABs we were talking about earlier. The impact of SES 2 on air service providers and ROMATSA is explained in the new reference framework, which is directly applicable. The ICAO and the national authority have to coordinate. The supervisory authority has to be separated from the air traffic service provider. And starting with 2014, ROMATSA has taken over these tasks by following the government ordinance 645. We have come up with a performance scheme for 4 important fields: safety, environment, capacity, and cost efficiency. And we've also considered changes to the pricing scheme. We need incentives, we need tariffs for 3 to 5 years, we need to better identify the risks, etc. Another important point is accelerating the integration of the air traffic services in FABs. FABs no longer take into account the ground or the land borders, and I think this concept is just a step to prepare us for what will come next. And we know that the air traffic management network will have to be consolidated by this whole ATM concept. We, ROMATSA, are a supporter of this new legal package, SES2+, and we work closely with the state authority in order to implement its provisions. I think we need to simplify the existing regulations in order to implement this package. We need to eliminate any overlaps regarding the regulation program and to clarify the roles of all bodies. I believe we don't have to interfere with the business model of the air navigation service providers. As long as the support services are separated from the air navigation services. But this should be decided at local level. We have to take into account local cultural specificities. Opening this sector to competition can be done. This can be an option, but it should only happen if all the safety standards are ensured and checked by the competent authority. We believe that expanding the role of the network manager by giving it new tasks that will be centralized should only be done after a detailed consultation process. This consultation should focus on the interests of air navigation service providers. This should only happen if there is an added value to be found. As for the performance scheme, I think that the local performance targets should be decided at national level or at the level of the FABs, because we want to make sure that the local targets contribute to EU targets. As for these FABs, I think we have to delete any obligation on establishing and implement them based on the integrated air services. I think we have to be mindful of trade union strikes and any actions that might distort the network. We have to consult with all the users of the airspace on all the aspects of providing services or deciding tariffs. But the user should not be given a voice in approving the strategic investment plans. They have to be approved by the NSA alone, because that's where the authority lies. Thank you. Thank you.